Welcome back to Insomnia True Silver Championship. I'm Nimsh and I'm here with Sottl and Lothar to bring you the third quarterfinal. But before we talk about the players specifically, let's look at the bracket and where are we today? Because this is the third day of the tournament. We had Swiss, we had group stages, and now it's single elimination.
Yeah, so far, as you can see from our first two games, Powder and Dog have qualified to these semifinals, making it a potential for a real powerhouse top four. Life Coach and Ness is the game that we're looking at now. And then there's the battle of the two underdogs, although that may be selling Pokrovac a little bit short considering his impressive showing in the EU finals and the previous weeks. But it's shaping up to be a very impressive top four overall, Lothar.
Yeah, definitely. Like, the lower bracket seems to be less stacked than the higher bracket. We can agree on that. But still, Powder and Dog already in the top four makes a good final, because we know that Dog and Powder will be a part of that, right? And now we just have to wait for the other players to advance to the top four. And I guess, when I would have to make a guess here, Life Coach and Pokrovac would be my picks.
Sure, I think they'd go down as the favorites, but again, I said in the sign-off to the previous series, I was really impressed with how Ness played in the latter series that he played yesterday. The former was very shaky, but you made the point on one cast that if you're going to be nervous on stage, that's something you have to get over quickly if you're going to do well in a tournament. I think that's exactly what Ness did. He brought it together in the second series, played much better, so he's definitely got a good shot against Life Coach here.
Absolutely. Life Coach, tons of experience, many tournaments won already for him. Last season, he got eliminated in the top eight, I believe.
By RDU,
the champion. Right. And then Ness got eliminated as in the top eight as well, so they were in the same place. But Sottl, can you tell us more about Ness? Like, who is he?
Ness is, at this point, basically the UK's king of Insomnia. I mean, Insomnia kind of came to front as an international tournament just previously with this tournament and the one before it. Ness has now been top eight in both of those. But before that, when it was really only a UK tournament, the last one of those that previously happened before we transformed into the True Silver format, Ness was actually in the grand finals against Dignitas's Blackout. So he is a very successful competitor in UK tournaments in general, known very well known here in the UK, still trying to build his name internationally. But if he keeps making great showings in tournaments like this, then he's going to get there very fast.
That's certainly pretty impressive. And Lothar, a lot of people know Life Coach, but for people who don't know Life Coach, what can you tell them?
Well, ex-pro poker player. A life coach, literally. He gives life advice on his stream, so that's very enjoyable. And that's his nickname. That's the reason why he's nicknamed like this in Hearthstone. And he is known as the powerhouse of Hearthstone and I think the biggest thinker in the scene, because he takes so much time to think about the game in general, right? He's known for making an example. All those screenshots during his games to analyze the games after the game. Even if he wins, he analyzes the game. So, and that's something that I think the top tier players are always doing. Like Firebat said in the VT, right? He said that you have to work really hard for that 1% to increase your win ratio. And I think all those small steps are giving you that small advantage, and that will be very important in those situations here in this stage.
Yeah, I think Life Coach has become so famous for that screenshot analysis that it's now just become like the coined term for it. You hear other streamers say, okay, I'm going to Life Coach this turn, and then they press print screen to get the screenshot. So yeah, he's a very, very deep analytical thinker, one of the most impressive players, one of the few players who've had a streak in Hearthstone where they just seemed unbeatable for a while.
Oh, yeah.
He was just winning everything. You know, Firebat's been through the same thing. Tice has been through the same thing. That's pretty much the only three. I guess Kalento as well, as periods, has had that same aura around him. So definitely, as you said, powerhouse is a great word for him.
Absolutely. Now, and I can't really wait for the match, but we actually had a chance to talk to both players. So let's see what they have to say.
I've been already to Insomnia once, and it was just an awesome experience. I really have a great time here and enjoy myself. 70% of those are like my friends, so for me it feels like a little bit like friendly matches, and I'm really happy that we have such a community. In these Swiss tournaments, they are quite skill heavy, and skill really matters a lot because you play a lot of games, like 7 rounds in that case. So, this is also something I really find important, that you see that permanent skill also gets rewarded in the long run, perhaps not in one match, not perhaps in two matches, but after 7 matches, the likelihood is not 10-15% as you would expect, but it's much higher. It feels great to go through to the finals.
I'm
really happy that I got through to top 8. Just like last time when I made it, I was exhilarated. Competition's been really tough. Biggest challenge for me was playing on stage for the first round, so I had to play against Soleil on stream, and I knew his lineup was favored against mine, and the pressure of being on stage as well, it kind of gets to me sometimes. My mindset for going into top 8 is to just keep calm, keep trying my best, think about what my opponent will play first, and try and predict the right one and pick the right deck. To my opponents, you might not have known who I was before, but hopefully you know who I am now after some good performances. You might think Priest is an awful class, but I think it's good, and I'm ready to show you that it can beat your lineup.
Like, personally, I'm really excited to see Ness play because not only he said he got stressed on stage, but this will be his third match on this specific stage.
Right.
Yesterday, he played two of them. He brought Priest and he brought this mid-range Warlock. That's a very interesting deck as well.
Yeah, there's a couple of variations of the Warlock in this tournament. It's a thing that's been around in various forms on ladder. It kind of pops up every now and again, every few months. Kind of just gets slapped with the title of Weird Lock, where it's just like early game zoo cards, then you have more stuff later on. Like in Ness's case, he has more late game stuff, more AoE, has dark bombs as well to be able to push extra damage. So it's a style of Warlock that comes in and out of vogue every now and again, but this is kind of the biggest concentration that I've seen of it maybe in one tournament, because Ness is playing it, Boar Control, who is a good friend and practice partner of Ness, was playing it in the Swiss as well, and then we saw was it Johnny Storm who was playing a different version as well? He was playing the mage. So Kamlan maybe?
Kamlan was playing.
Kamlan, yeah. With the Azure Drakes, Leper Gnome, Sludge Belcher, again, yeah. With the Zoo cards as well. So definitely that kind of mid-range Warlock thing is making a splash in this tournament for sure.
Absolutely. And there's also Life Coach's Rogue that I believe we haven't seen yesterday. He won without using the Rogue on stage. Yep. So this is a mystery Rogue for the moment. Possibly Oil. We know like Life Coach was playing the Greedy Gadgetzan version in the past tournament.
Right. If you're familiar with Life Coach's stream, I think you have a decent idea of what the Rogue build is. He's kind of famous for this sort of no win condition Gadgetzan Rogue, where
it's just
Gadgetzan and board control kind of thing. Just cycle your deck, keep control of the board. So that's what I would expect it to be personally. I think if people are scouting out Life Coach, know him well, that's what they'd expect as well.
What is interesting about Life Coach is that almost never, Life Coach never brings a deck that he didn't playtest for like at least 100 games.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
So if he playtests those decks, it's usually made on stream, so people kind of, you know, get those information just from his streams, right? Because he likes his odds, and he only will get decent information about the deck itself when he plays a really huge amount of games with that deck.
Absolutely, and one of those decks is his Handlock. So Lothar, what can you tell us about that deck?
Well, he's playing with the old era Handlock, which is, you know, known for every single viewer, I think, and players to be one of the most intense decks in general in Hearthstone, but also a great deck against Priest. But first game is between the Rogue and the Priest, so let's focus on that.
Yeah, so it seems like Life Coach won the mind games in a way, right? This Rogue should be good versus Priest. Originally, Rogue was always good versus Priest. Is this still the case, Sol?
It definitely is. Ness's build has a little bit of an edge, a little bit less of a disadvantage because of the inclusion of Harrison Jones that we saw from him yesterday. He was able to defeat a Rogue by crushing a two-charge oiled dagger in the matchup that he had to play with the Priest against Rogue. So that can definitely get some stuff done, but generally the Priest just gives the Rogue too much time, and Rogue is a deck that if you give time to, they will generally just beat everything in the game if they're allowed to set up their plays. But you know, Zombie Chow into Velen's Chosen early on could get some early pressure going for the Priest. Anything can happen here, and I will also say that Ness is a very experienced Priest player. This is not Priest being brought as a meta call to the tournament. He brought Priest to the last Insomnia as well. This is just his favorite class. It's what he likes to play, so he's comfortable playing Priest in most matchups.
And it works in most of the cases. Like, to this kind of tournament, as Lothar mentioned about Life Coach, just he needs to play 100 games with the deck, and then he is confident to bring it. I think it's a really good call overall. If you bring a meta deck that you are not accustomed with, you can make a lot of misplays. And even though the deck is supposed to be good, you would just play badly.
I mean, absolutely. We saw Nostum, this is the counter-argument to that. He won North American Championships while admittedly saying that he's bringing what he thinks is the best decks that are not necessarily what he's the most experienced with, because he likes to play more innovative, wacky kind of stuff. But I mean, it can go both ways. You can go with the deck that you think you can push your win percentage highest with through your personal mastery of it, or you can just bring what you consider to be the best decks overall. So Ness definitely favoring his home class here of Priest as much as he can. And you saw in the VT interview that we saw he's willing to come out here and show that Priest can get the job done.
Absolutely. So this turn three, Valence Chosen will be super weak to stop, which is a possibility. Deathlord, Aqua of Pain, what do you go for?
This is the turn when you have to think about turn five in general, because you know that if you play the Acolyte of Pain, you probably will have to use a hero power on the Acolyte of Pain from turn four, so you don't have mana for the three drop. So if you just play the Acolyte of Pain, basically leaves you open too many outs from the rogue, so I like the Deathlord more. And Valence Chosen will not be played until there's a moment when you can trade with your minion. So definitely Deathlord was the only option.
Life Coach here just going to go ahead and coin out that Tomb Pillager. Tomb Pillager is such a flexible card. You can kind of play it on turn three as the coin, as a pure 3-mana 5-4, because you get that coin back in your hand afterwards. So definitely, you've essentially just played it for 3-mana. So such an effective card to use in a variety of situations, either to just for a tempo play early or to store up an extra coin for a bigger play later on with an Auctioneer, with Van Cleef, with Malagos. So much utility from this card.
Let's evaluate the hands a bit more on this turn. So looking at both hands from both players, who has a better hand at the moment?
Hard to judge the book by its cover, because both of those decks are capable of swinging the, just replacing those cards in this hand frequently, right? So it's really hard to say. Even if there will be a sap next turn, the rogue doesn't build his board, he can't get rid of the Deathlord, but his hand has bigger ability, like the bigger comeback ability, right? When Ness has a board control, right now he has board control, but his hand is more clunky.
Interesting decision there from Ness not to use the Flash Heal to protect his Zombie Chow. Does expose him now potentially to an Eviscerate from Life Coach, but he's obviously valuing that Flash Heal for the potential huge tempo turns you can get with an Orcanized Soul Priest later on, as well as eventual burst damage. So he's going to be happy with this board right now. He's a long way ahead. His hand is running out of steam, but he has that double Acolyte of Pain hand that can bring him more options later on.
Absolutely. I wonder how the matchup will change, how Ness is going to play this game overall, because if he feels like this is a bad matchup, which we agree it is a bad matchup for the Priest, he will have to make maybe more risky decisions, or also, like as mentioned, just keep the Flash here for possible Arcanine and Burst. Might be the only way to win the game, actually, for him.
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely a possibility. Just again, just the amount of minions in the deck as well. You know, Violet Teacher, Gadgetzan Auctioneer, Tomb Pillager that can be targeted by the Orcanized Soul Priest Flash Heal combination as well. Like, fantastic tempo play in any of those situations.
All right, so Lothar, what do you think? What do you do now as Ness? There is a Holy Nova draw, which might be quite good overall, especially because there is also the Valence Chosen, so it's spell damage.
The Holy Nova is cage, I would say, but thinking about the Flash Heal and just hero power this turn, it's 3 damage from the Holy Nova, so you can clear the Edwin Van Cleef with your Zombie Chow, but you don't want to sacrifice it this turn.
Yeah, I don't really even mind leaving the Van Cleef up, just trading the Chow or the Deathlord into the Bloodmage Thaunos, dropping an Acolyte of Pain and just healing one of your minions, and then you know maybe you'll lose your Deathlord that way, but you do have the Holy Nova in hand for some AoE. You have an Entomb if anything particularly nasty comes out, so I think that's a reasonable line to consider here as well.
And Ness might be thinking that there's no sap,
right?
Because the sap would have been played already against the Zombie Troll with the Valence Chosen, so he might not anticipate that.
Yeah, it looks like that is the line we're going to see here. And by using the Deathlord to trade, he does 100% concede his Deathlord to the board, which is interesting. So he's making this play with full recognition. He's prepared to lose his Deathlord this turn.
Yeah, definitely.
And that means he has something prepared for the next turn.
Exactly.
Drop,
that's
right?
The read you can get as the opponent from that situation.
Yeah, so Life Coach right now has the information that there might be some kind of AoE coming. What AoEs are open for Ness? Have we seen Light Bomb in this deck?
Yeah, I mean, that's the first alarm bell that's going to go off in Life Coach's head right there. It's like, he can see, based on the trades that happened, that Ness has conceded his Deathlord to this board. So he's going to say, okay, you know, this is how Deathlord is used in Priest. It pulls extra minions out of my deck, and then it gets caught in all this AoE that they have. So suddenly the fear of God is in Life Coach, where he's like, okay, maybe I just can't commit too hard to this board now, because I'll play too hard into a potential Light Bomb.
Maybe it would have been better to sap the Deathlord and just stack into the Zombie Chop.
Sure.
Well, he's going for the Deathlord. If he gets a Gadgetzan, that would be quite an interesting card to have on board. Oh. And he gets one!
Got him!
Wow! So this is great for Life Coach. He'll be able to replace some of the cards in hand.
Hero Power first.
Yep. Right, yeah. Most of the time, you're not spending that two mana unless you get a seriously nice draw.
It would have been an Eviscerate from the top.
Again, situations in Hearthstone where the play looks wrong, but most of the time, you've done the right thing.
I mean, even with that Eviscerate on the top here, I would still just dagger wrap each single time. You can't really play for an two-outer from 18 cards left, or 19, I guess, when it's not game-changing.
Yeah. So, well, this situation looks great for Life Coach, getting that Gadgetzan from the Deathlord. And that's the risk of Deathlord. Like, on one hand, you can block the damage, you stall a bit, but if it hits card like Gadgetzan or Torison, you might just lose the game right there.
Yep. And Life Coach is going to be sat around pretty much expecting a Light Bomb here, but gets entombed instead. Little nod from Life Coach, definitely not as bad as expected, because the Light Bomb there would have cleared up two really nasty minions and drawn an extra card off the Acolyte of Pain for Ness. So he's perfectly happy with the entombed situation here, is now well ahead of this game. Card advantage, board advantage, tempo advantage. He has literally every measure of success in Hearthstone in his favor right now.
Absolutely, but this turn it's a bit weird in a way. He can play one card only, right?
I would say it's Belchertan, because it's the most awkward card to play in general in this curve. You want to save the agent for a combo of the backs of Eviscerate to clear whatever we played from the priest side. And Belcher is a tough minion to deal with for the priest. How do you deal with the Belcher if you don't have Shadowward Paints?
Yeah, sure, I don't mind that, but...
And it doesn't play into a Light Bomb as well, even though there was no Light Bomb this time, right?
Yep, I mean, I think Violet Teacher and Sludge Belcher are your two considerations this turn. They both play around Light Bomb pretty effectively. Sludge Belcher for all the reasons that you correctly pointed out, Lothar, but also Violet Teacher sets you up for a nice turn next turn, like, say, Sludge Belcher Eviscerate with the Violet Teacher already loaded on board, so definitely between those two. And we do see there was the Light Bomb top deck, so playing around it with one of the... bottom heavy minions with all the stats in the health was important here.
Were the times of playing around Shadow Madness?
Hey, it's still a good card.
It's still a good card, but might be playable only when Standard comes in.
Right.
Yeah, it will come back possibly as a 4-drop. Shadow War Death, a good way to deal with Edwin. Light Bomb, too expensive, not really doing anything to Belcher.
I think it's the turn when you Shadow War Death play Acolyte of Pain and Zombie Chow.
Yeah, it feels bad. You're just dropping the Acolyte of Pain into not only a 3-attack Belcher, but the 3-attack weapon as well. But you're not going anywhere fast with this hand right now as a priest. Although priest not a class interested in going anywhere fast a lot of the time, but he's going to need a few more options in his hand overall, I think.
Yeah, not using the Acolyte of Pain. I was just thinking about the Acolyte of Pain because your hand is basically worthless when it comes to card value.
Agreed.
So the Acolyte of Pain is like a needed cycle to get through it.
And think about how big of an effect a single Orcanai Soul Priest has
on
his hand right now.
Exactly, that was my point as well. Yeah, the Orcanai is an MVP card in this situation because it changes the flash heals into flash kill commands. Mm-hmm. And it's very important to get the to get the board control back, especially against minions like Tomb Pillagers, Gadgetzans, and Violet Teachers. And you know that a Life Coach plays a Emperor Thorison as well in this deck.
Maybe Ness is thinking not only about cycling Acolyte, but trying to draw more cards with it if he picks the Pyromancer in the future. So he feels like he is behind right now, and AoE might not be that great for him at the very moment. So he can win this game by outvalueing Rogue, which will be pretty hard because Rogue was able to draw a lot of cards and still has 6 cards in hand.
To be honest, I don't think you can spare so much as a single turn of attacks from the Rogue if you plan to go for the Pyromancer Rod, which you don't have in your hand, so basically rely on drawing an out from your deck and waiting for Acolyte of Pain into Light Bomb is still two turns away. So cycle was basically more important than just risking it.
Sure. Can you explain why he didn't play it then? What was in his mind?
No idea.
I mean, I think what you described is probably what he was thinking. I just don't think that thinking is correct in this line. Like, I think that just, you know, it's hard to get into the player's head a lot of the times and work out what they are thinking, especially if you consider that reasoning to be faulty. And I think he does just want to be a bit greedier with that Acolyte of Pain. Like I said, it felt bad in that situation. 3 attack Belcher, 3 attack Weapon, but he just needs to get to that Orcanite Soul Priest as quickly as he can. It's pretty much his only out in this situation.
Definitely, yeah.
Because now, even though he set up a Life Bomb for next turn, it still doesn't necessarily help him because he's losing tempo, right?
Yep.
There's 9 damage stacking, and even though this Rogue is not really oppressively aggressive, right? 9 damage, basically double eviscerate in an attack from the hero power. So you will leave a 1-2 from the Belcher behind. If, let's say, Life Coach would have been played an oil in this deck, mm-hmm. it probably will be GG already.
Yep. Pretty much, and like the ball is completely in Life Coach's court right now. He does not have to commit anything. This nine damage a turn is a good enough clock to just attack, pass, like go ahead and light bomb me. But he also just has the option to play a teacher if he wants to that's resistant to the light bomb as well. So
because it really telegraphs the light bomb from that side.
Absolutely, yeah.
But from Ness's perspective, if he light bombs next turn, he will be able to play Acolyte into a possible 1-2 slime. So bait on a weapon attack, and now without the weapon buff, the 1-2 is possibly giving him more draws with the Acolyte.
It's interesting that Emperor was played this turn. Lifecoat has to acknowledge that there will be a light bomb next turn, so he deliberately chooses to play the Emperor into a removal, right?
Right, I think the idea here is that by cheapening this whole hand, like he doesn't need the Emperor necessarily as a minion, so he knows that Light Bomb comes down from his opponent here, and then he has a full turn of tempo because the whole turn was a removal turn from his opponent. So he now has this free tempo turn next turn to go Violet Teacher turn, Gadgetzan turn, whatever the hell he wants. So getting the discount helps him do that a lot more.
But suddenly, there's...
He is really close to losing to a double kill command and hero power.
Yeah, it's even like if there is Circle of Healing, I think that's probably over as well, because then he can play Zombie Giant, deal extra 5 damage.
Right.
Face. So there's a lot of damage potential right now for Ness, but I think it's still the Light Bomb turn.
Well, it can't right. really do anything else.
Yeah, there's no creative way to get more damage out of your Zombie Child this turn either. So Justicar Trueheart to buff the hero power, that could give him lethal, and then the Circle of Healing to kill the Zombie Child as well. Those are the two options to kind of up the damage here. So Ness will be perhaps looking for a way to set up a 2-turn lethal here with the Light Bomb, and he can do that with either of those cards, which is really interesting. So there is suddenly a chance for him to recover here.
Yeah, definitely. And
I don't like this. I do not like the heal phase there at all.
He is playing into a win next turn, right? So if you want to play into a win next turn,
right.
you need to cycle again
yep.
to get those
exactly.
cards that you need to finish up the game. Those cards are basically 2 Circle of Healings, nothing else.
Right, so he could have done that in one of two ways. Nausea Cleric healed the Nausea Cleric, or just played the Acolyte of
yes.
Pain.
Yeah,
might bomb the Acolyte right of Pain and skip the healing entirely. I think both of those lines are more effective overall because he really needs that Circle of Healing primarily to just give him lethal next turn. If failing that, get the Justicar and try and stay alive for a couple of turns and set it up that way.
And that was also, I thought, the reasoning to keep that Acolyte of Pain to be able to draw that card on turn 9. Right now, Northshire Cleric didn't change anything, and maybe Ness is thinking about a different ending to this game, but like looking at 4 out of 5 cards in his hand, it seems like a clear ending to me.
Yeah, I mean, just I'm a big advocate of doing what your hand says, and right now this hand says circle for that last cycle for that last bit of damage that you need, which is the circle,
yeah.
and then you'll be able to push through. And like Ness is not really recognizing that situation.
One
right
damage of lethal.
Is there anything he can actually get there?
Circle of healing. That's the only thing.
Power shield still leaves plenty of mana available. He cannot power chill the Zombie Chow, though. That makes life very awkward, so he's going to have to find some way. He's going to have to play the Orcanite, power chill the Orcanite. It's pretty much his
only out.
That's his only out,
yes. And if he draws the Circle of Healing, he wins the game.
Yes.
If he doesn't draw it, that's GG.
And imagine Acolyte of Pain on board. He will be able to draw 2 more cards.
Yep.
That. And the last card, is it a circle? No, it's Deathlord.
All right, I mean, Deathlord is a card, so he may have to just abandon the full-out phase strategy and just represent the Deathlord in play now.
Mm-hmm.
Use one of the Flash Heals to take down at least the 5-4 here, maybe commit both of them to take out the 2 problematic minions, take full control of the board with Orcanite and the Deathlord.
Yeah, it's a valid strategy for sure.
So yeah, I don't mind this. He's pushed through on the lethal plan, didn't commit to it maybe as hard as he could have done, and now he should recognize the right time to bail out on this. Although, is he going to play the Zombie Chow instead of the second Flash Heal? Okay, that's interesting.
So he's still thinking about bursting down his opponent.
He is.
But how can you burst down when you play the zombie troll?
Right. He's banking on that thing somehow dying. He's playing it now, so it has initiative next turn. He's able to kill it and set up lethal that way, but puts the ball in your opponent's court to be able to deal with the Orcanai and then get the health back.
But the Orcanai will die instead.
Right.
That's the problem. Backstab,
yeah, exactly.
Eviscerate.
Exactly.
And your zombie child basically sits there awkwardly because Life Coach knows there's no second Orcanai because it would have been played already, right?
Yes.
The turn before the first Orcanai.
And there is a chance you actually draw into the second Orcanai. But yeah, Life Coach definitely is killing this Orcanai this turn. And another thing is, like, Ness was hoping that Orcanai will survive behind the stone wall.
So sacrifice the 1-1 to get another 1-1 from the Visceral. He's waiting for a draw, because that's basically 2 damage.
He needs to be very careful here, not just accidentally kill that zombie chow with splash damage here.
That's fine.
The Orcanai dying at the same time, so it's perfectly reasonable.
Wow,
what a turn. Now I'm just...
I mean, yeah, Life Coach, if you've got this all in before the rope, then congratulations. Then if you've been punished again by your slow turns, then the Eviscerate is going to come down here, hit the Deathlord. He's not going to get the minion out, but he is going to clear it out of the way, pushes through the damage. Looks like he's managed to queue up everything.
Wow.
Yep. Good job, Life Coach.
Wow. That was an impressive turn. Wow, and Ness just concedes there.
That took like 20 seconds from Ness' turn.
Yeah. Yep, animation bugs, Nozdormu mode activated.
That first game was incredible, actually. Ness almost had it. It was super close. If you would play Uncle Eye of Pain, he maybe would be able to see one more card, but we know that Elise was there. Elise was a blank. Wouldn't help Ness.
It wouldn't be one card, it would have been at least 2.
Yeah, so he could have played Acolyte earlier on when we were first talking about it. That would have been 1 card, and then on the following turn, he would have done the Norsha Cleric heal, Norsha Cleric play, so he would have ended up 2 cards deeper. So there is still potential that the circle would have been there.
Or the turn when he played the Light Bomb, he would have played Acolyte.
Yes.
With the Light Bomb, so he would have get 1 card from the Acolyte that turn, and then the second card, another second card the turn after, during his opponent's turn.
When the Acolyte dies, yeah, that was my reasoning to begin with. But he went for the Norsha Cleric, he didn't see the cards he needed. So Life Coach took the first game and eliminated Priest. Now we're going to see Druid from Ness versus Life Coach's no win condition rogue.
Yeah, your win condition is a sick miracle turn that is done entirely in the length of one rope where you clear your opponent's board and push a bunch of damage. That's apparently the win condition, but Innovate Shredder in hand from Ness, one of the classic Druid openings. Not too bad. Lotheb also a very key card against Rogue, and with the strength of his opener here, he may even decide just to hang on to that as well. But this is the kind of hand you'd love to keep with a Wild Growth, not so much just with an Innovate that doesn't quite fill out the curve properly. So lots of decisions to be made here from Ness.
So I have to ask you guys, Lothar first, what do you think this matchup is? Like, a lot of people argue, like, obviously, when I ask Lothar, there's a Wild Growth, but do you think that, like, without like Wild Growths and Innervates overall, who's an edge? Is it a 50-50 or is it like Rogue favored?
Druid is favored, in my opinion, almost in every single situation. And the what Rogue player has to do to get an edge against the Druid player is just to play minions. That's the only way you can make a comeback, because Druid is known to have hard times.
Oh my god. Continue, please.
Yeah, I just caught off guard by those draws. This is like ridiculous. Now Life Coach has to find a way to kill this minion or just sap it back, right? Well, I think the only way he can make a comeback right now is the advent, right? Coin, deadly poison, prep, sap, into advent. And pray your opponent doesn't have a keeper.
Yeah.
Or a big game hunter. If you're going all the way in and making it as big as possible, then you're also praying that he doesn't have the big game hunter. Or you can sequence it for the deliberate 6-6 as well, if you want to do it that way.
Is 6-6 enough? Because you know it dies to 2 cards from the druid.
Yeah, Life Coach.
Life Coach says it is. So I'm going to go with Life Coach here.
He's playing around big game hunter. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, this is fine because one of the cards you'll be expecting is Druid of the Claw based on the curve here. So 6-6 just trades into it really nicely. But the keeper top deck is huge, and now Emperor just comes down again next turn if he wants it to.
Yeah, but then like it actually was okay in a way for Life Coach because he didn't go all in, so he didn't lose that much with the Edwin being silenced. Obviously, it's not good because Edwin is now just a 2-2. Still, this game is not over yet.
Another prep, which is awesome for 10-6. but it doesn't give him anything right now.
Yeah, and this is a rare situation in Hearthstone where you are 100% confident what your opponent's next turn will be.
Yeah.
You still have pretty much no way to stop it. Like, how do you set up a play here that lets you deal with Emperor Thorazan next turn?
There's no way to plan it.
Yeah.
You have to top deck a Eviscerate. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, you're in a bad position. I would say that if you know that there's the Emperor Thorazan next turn, you might just keep the Deadly Poison in your hand and not play it this turn.
Can you even set up like a bluff situation where your opponent maybe doesn't play the Emperor because it looks like you're setting up to deal with it? Because there's a lot of information going on back and forth here. Like, everyone has like a big info on how this game's progressing because of the threat of that Emperor.
I think there is basically no way to bluff Druid out of playing the Thorazan. You always want to play Thorazan. It's a great body, 5/5. You need to deal with it, and you reduce the cards in your hand. You will have 4 cards.
Yeah. I think, Nimsh, that may have been the stupidest question I've ever asked someone. I'm quite proud of it. I'm going to take that one to the bank.
Yeah, it was a really solid question. It was almost rhetorical.
Yes, indeed. So anyway, Emperor this turn. Let's go.
And double wraps for 1 mana. Seems like a good investment. Basically, by playing the Emperor, you gain 2 innovates, which are built in into the cards, so they're better than actually drawing the innovates.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah, Ness, that's it. Mouse over all these other options that you have in hand, convince your opponent that your hand is godlike, and then just play the Emperor anyway. We know what's happening here. Come on. There we go.
So for Life Coach, a backstab is something that can deal with Emperor. A sap rate. Sap draw?
Nope.
Vladimir Thalnos, not really.
Ooh, it's not looking good for Life Coach. He needs to play it at Thalnos, I think.
We're just gonna coin out his own Emperor here. Yeah,
okay.
This is gonna get dug out by those Wraths in Ness's hand, which have the byproduct of just cycling more cards to get Emperor discounted into Ness's hand. So this works out okay for Ness, but it does speed up the hand. And the swipe off the top doesn't even draw first. Gets so excited about the swipe that he sequences things badly. Uses the zero mana wrath, so he can develop the Druid of the Claw as well. And now Savage Roar comes into the hand as well to get discounted.
Yeah, he has.
Lothar, on a scale of 1 to Brokeback, how much are you enjoying this Druid game right now?
I'm really enjoying Druid almost every single time, especially when Innovate and Emperors are involved. I'm really happy that Innovate will not be in standard. Oh, wait.
Oh, wow. Okay. It might get nerfed, though.
Hopefully, because this card is like the Black Lotus for Hearthstone, and we all know how that ended up.
Yeah, so that ended up badly with huge fireballs to face. But yeah, there is a sap for Life Coach, so at least he's able to draw some cards. This shenanigans.
Emperor back to the hand again.
What do you think about the Druid of the Claw instead of the Piloted Shredder last turn? I always like to play the minions that have immediate effect. I like to play the minions that doesn't have immediate effect on the board the turn before, right?
I think maybe just getting it down to protect the Emperor was his thinking, but I agree with you because he drew the Savage Roar off the Wrath cycle, so keeping the Druid of the Claw in hand for the Druid of the Claw plus Savage Roar combo definitely makes a lot of sense there, but also just more mana efficient to play the 3 mana Druid of the Claw instead of the 1 mana Piloted Shredder, or the 2 mana Piloted Shredder as it was then, so. I can understand the thinking, but I liked keeping it in hand for the charge plus Savage Roar combo as well. And let's just jam Emperor again. Why the hell not, right?
Guess who's back?
At this point, it doesn't really matter.
Yeah, it doesn't at all. I would just play it for the meme here. Like,
come on,
hey.
I still enjoy my zero mana Shredder if possible. Oh, he's going for the
Come on.
I like that.
I like
denying,
it. Yeah, I mean,
denying the draw is very important.
Yeah, seriously speaking, I think this is actually the better play. I just want to play Emperor Ping Pong as much as possible right now. It's been sapped twice. I think you're just comedically obligated to jam it back onto the board.
But now so many cards win the game. Forest, Druid of the Claw is a charge. Azujik doesn't.
It's 12 damage right now to the face. 13 damage with the hero power.
Yeah.
It's not yet there.
Can he pick like Living Roots? No, not really.
Second
couple?
Savage Roar.
One mana off.
Couldn't quite see how much mana the first Savage Roar costs, so he's not quite there just yet, meaning that he's going to have to wait a little bit here, possibly pick up the Force of Nature to be able to push this through.
Can you actually still go face? Because you're playing versus Rogue. Even though Rogue has 11 damage on board at the very moment, like if you just Savage Roar to face with everything, you should not die from that position against this kind of Rogue.
But you will not die, but Rogue might have the ability to clear up the entire board, and you use already one swipe, you use one Druid with a claw, you have two Force of Natures in the deck, and that's about it.
Yeah, but is there a better alternative, like Savage Roar and start trading
right.
in the boom?
I don't think there's any real use of holding two Savage Roars in your hand, and you're not doing anything this turn except going face anyway, so I feel like you might as well just commit the Savage Roar, right?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
So it's not really gaining you anything. Your outs are still pretty much the same, keeping minions on board, using the second Savage Roar, or drawing more damage, but... yeah, there's just kind of no reason not to do it. You might as well just max out on damage as hard as you can.
So now for Life Coach, he definitely needs to clear the board. He knows being at five, a lot of cards just kill him straight away. He has no option to gain life. So a swipe, from Life Coach's perspective, swipe, Druid of the Claw with hero power is 5 damage.
Yeah.
5 is a really bad number to be at against the Druid.
Sure is. And also the fact that the spell damage has been silenced off that Blood Mage Thalnos is a really big deal right now, because the Blade Flurries in hand, looking at this board state right now, would start doing a lot of work. So the silence was used primarily to deny the card draw for the Rogue, but just as a happy byproduct, removing the spell damage is doing a lot of work right now as well.
Can he even clear?
He might struggle to do it without taking damage here. He might have to poke something to set up a better Blade Flurry potentially here, depending on what this second Boombot does. He is going to go ahead and do it, and if he makes this attack, he's dead just to the Savage Roar that's in hand.
Yeah, and he does that.
Well, that's quite unfortunate. And Death Rattles, the bombs are being dealt damage after death.
Ooh!
Well,
it didn't end up mattering, but...
Well,
and concedes.
Yeah, Life Coach, just with a little sticking out of the tongue there, a big smile on his face. Wrathguard hits face, doesn't have to reveal the second Savage Roar in hand, concealing the fact that he does, in fact, play two Savage Roars in his Druid deck.
Really?
Yeah, that's really rare, right? Superb. Excellent tech choice decision from Ness to play Emperor Thorason and two Savage Roars in his Druid deck.
Play Emperor Thorason 3 times.
Yeah. Oh, no, he didn't. He only played it twice.
Oh, you're right. He didn't play it.
Somehow resisted the urge to just jam it back the third time. He's a bigger man than I am, for sure.
That game is crazy.
It actually mattered, because the drop from the Palter Shredder was more important.
Yeah, I agree.
To more HP on the minion.
Although, if he'd have played the Emperor again, that Savage Roar would have cost 1 mana instead of 2, meaning he would have been able to cast double Savage Roar on the turn that he drew Savage Roar.
Yeah, that's right. All right. Druid Mirror, both Druids getting the Wildgrowth and Ness getting the coin. That can be an interesting match, or a very swingy one.
Yeah, I mean, both players have the turn one kind of irritating Living Roots. That's kind of what it is in the Druid Mirror. It's not much more than that. It's just an annoyance, and they both have the Wildgrowth, but Ness has the minions to go to from there, whereas Life Coach is going to have to trust his deck a little bit.
At least the deck density from the Druid is high, right? Yes. So you have more chances to actually draw the minions.
And also, importantly in this matchup, I think Life Coach has initiative. I think you'd rather be going first in the Druid Mirror, because it's so much about on-curve threats. So he's able to just start doing everything first, especially since the hands are so similar here.
Yeah, and in a way, it's like a tempo match, because whoever gets advantage and is able to deal more damage will have the threat combo and can win the game easier. But so I've seen the Druid Mirrors being really swingy, and both players just sitting at around 16 health, and both having combo in hand and not really able to pull the trigger and win the game. So we'll see how it turns out. But
no one wants to play. This is like, yeah, we go face.
Yep. Both players are playing Druid correctly right now. Turn one, Living Roots. Turn two, Wildgrowth. Hitting the face repeatedly. They have both read the Druid Handbook, all 2 pages of it, and they have digested it completely.
For Lyokov, this is a really bad spot, because now he knows that his best way to win against a Druid is a mirror match. That's not a good sign.
Yeah, he has the Handlock as well. Yeah. With Handlock, he has a chance, but Handlock is unfavored versus Druid.
So, not drawing a 4-drop or even a 3-drop in this situation for the 10-4 is putting him on the back foot, a heavy back foot, actually. Because now, if Ness will play any kind of creature on board, he's ahead. And he has the coin still in his hand, so he can play either a 4-drop, a 5-drop, or a Innervate Emperor.
Innervate Emperor is quite good in the mirror match.
Wow.
In any match. Overall, in Hearthstone, I think it wins games.
I think the success rate of Innervating Emperor is pretty damn high, yeah.
Yeah. The quality of his hand is not the best, but still just the 5-5 on board and being able to apply minus 3.
Trade into a 1-1 to play around Savage Roar here. You still do kill it with Savage Roar, but you at least pass 5 face damage to your opponent in the byproduct. So I think killing a 1-1 there is perfectly reasonable. And now it's not the best Emperor, but the tempo that it does bring you with the cheaper Druid of the Claw and Wrath, etc., does get a lot of work done in the long term.
The question is, do you charge into it?
I think you have to. You can't really allow Druid to have Emperor for 2 turns. I mean, the third turn was redundant last game, right?
You want to Druid of the Claw charge it? You'd rather Druid of the Claw charge it than Savage Roar, right?
I think so.
Really?
When you have the combo ready in hand, so you have a comeback mechanism when you fall back again.
Okay. Yeah, all right, sure, I buy that. Makes sense.
Yeah, Druid of the Claw is just a 5 draw. It's not like you're doing...
It's a hell of a minion in the matchup, though. Just in stat form on the board, the 4-6 is really difficult for the opposing Druid to deal with.
But you do have, like, 2 other 5 drops you want to play at some point.
Yeah, that makes sense.
I'll definitely keep the Azure Drake in my hand when I have a Wrath 1 mana.
Yes.
It kills opposing minions with 4 HP, so basically other Azure Drakes, right? And basically that's my reasoning.
It's the same thing. Like, you play it on an empty board, and you expect your opponent to play something. If Life Coach plays his own Emperor, you just kill it with Hero Power and the Wrath for 1. If there is a Sylvanas, well, we haven't seen Sylvanas from Life Coach though, yet.
No, Sylvanas still pretty niche in Druid overall. It was a mainstay a while ago, mostly cycled out. We've seen it, I believe, once in this tournament.
Yeah, under one.
From Dog in the Swiss round before he cut it out for top 16, so yeah.
Dr. Boom for this turn is also quite juicy.
Probably Nez will go for the Dr. Boom, but I think the correct choice would be the Wrath and Druid of the Claw. Just to build the board without leaving a spell power for your opponent, unless you want to trade the Azure Drake into the Azure Drake.
I think I do agree strongly because of Big Game Hunter. If you are ahead and you have a great way to set up a second minion that's not easy to answer and just start pushing damage, I think that's better than just Dr. Boom, which gives a Life Coach a chance if there's the Big Game Hunter and maybe a swipe to just clear the board.
Yep, Ness recognizes the situation. Like I said, this 4-6 minion is just a massive pain for Druid to deal with, so I love generating it on the board here. Life Coach gets a Druid of the Claw of his own, but I think it's probably just Ancient of Lore time unless he feels like he really needs to react to this board state immediately.
He can innervate combo to clear the board.
He can. That is a Hearthstone play that you can make this turn. I don't think it's particularly likely overall, though.
It's a huge investment. You play 3 cards to basically destroy 1 card.
Yeah.
The Ashen Drake was recycling, right? So
not value at all.
Wrath and Swipe are useful for fighting back onto the board here, especially in combination with that Innovate. He can actually use removal spells without losing too much tempo, but this board state is starting to get really out of control for Ness right now.
Unless Big Game Hunter.
Unless Big Game Hunter, but no Big Game Hunter. So he does have access to 10 total mana this turn, which is not quite enough to Drake, Swipe, and Wrath, which may have been enough to get the job done. It is enough to Force of Nature and Swipe, though, which may be what we go to here.
I don't think the spell power on the Swipe is that important, because you need 1 damage to kill off the Druid of the Claw.
Sure.
So, Wrath, Swipe on the Dr. Boom, clears up almost everything apart from the Druid of the... Azure Drake.
He seems to go for the combo.
He's just going to combo to clear instead. All right, this makes sense.
So yeah. Attack first with the...
Well, you attack with Hero into the 4-6, one of the strengths. Oh.
Yeah, I think he's going to resist taking damage as much as possible here. Didn't want to face tank before with his face, so he can do this relatively effectively. Does leave Boombots in play this way, but he is very, very afraid of taking that 4 damage to face from the Druid of the Claw.
And one bomb is still on the field, which means Savage Roar is more potent.
Yes.
Which is a
combo with the coin that Ness still has would have been lethal this turn, but you know what's a good card when your opponent's just handed you a full turn of initiative? Ancient of Lore.
Yep. Yeah, so Ness is super ahead this game still. And for Life Coach, he gets Thorsen. Better late than never.
Huh. Well, this turn is not easy. You can play Azure Drake into Swipe, basically, and that I think that's the best thing you can do. You still die to combo next turn because it's a 9.
You cannot play around combo anymore. I think you just need to forget that the combo exists.
Is there anything else you can do? The problem is that Boombots have a really small asterisk on its death rattle.
They always kill Azure Drakes.
Azure Drake is getting killed after this Boombot dies.
Oh!
I mean, it rolled the right number, it just missed by a couple of centimeters, just missed the target.
Right number for Ness, because now he's getting closer and closer, he might not even need the one combo part would be enough. He has 9 damage this turn? No, 7 damage.
Yes, 7 total damage using the coin as well to spend the full 10 mana, so not quite enough. He'll probably, I was going to say, you can even just afford to swipe the Drake here. You're in so much control of this game right now. Just protect that Shade of Naxxramas. Leaving the Drake on board means that your Shade can potentially die to splash effects from swipe if there's a second one, so this makes a lot of sense. Take the board control fully. You still have so many combo pieces left in your deck that as soon as you pretty much draw any of them, you're going to win this game on the
spot. Slow and steady. For Life Coach, it seems like Druid of Aquan, it's on form, Shade and Raft the 3-3.
Yep, seems reasonable.
Just take the power off board, be able to have a taunt on your own to protect yourself. 9 health is not a lot.
Yeah, so for the first time this game, Life Coach actually finds himself ahead on the board, but the question is the damage done from Ness? Is the early game advantage too strong that he's just going to be able to push through with this with the combo damage that will come out of the deck at some point? There is a Savage Draw and a Force of Nature with Silence in hand as well, castable this turn.
So he even goes for the Wrath and kill. He knows that he has to kill next turn, unless there is a Lotha being played by Life Coach, but unlikely.
Yeah, okay, so wrapping that and trading out instead of just silencing it and going face plays around the combo coming back at you this way. I think it would have been 25
yeah,
total
was just
damage. So
damage
yeah. You definitely need to deal with the minion.
That makes a lot more sense to do it that way. So good recognition from Ness again in that situation. And now Life Coach is looking at a collection of cards that do not save him from Treant smashing him in the face. So this is going to be another game to Ness and starting to tighten up his hold on this game, looking pretty impressive against Life Coach overall.
Yeah, definitely. As Lothar mentioned as well, this Druid will be really good versus Handlock. It's not unwinnable for Life Coach, but it will be a grinder. A really tough match.
Yeah, classically, back in the days of the Handlock meta, Druid was the natural predator. It was the one deck around on ladder when you were playing Handlock that you didn't really want to queue into. Just so much aggressive damage, so hard to wall them out. Keeper of the Groves for Twilight Drake, big game hunters for Giants. So definitely a rough matchup, Blast from the Past matchup, but that is what we'll be going into very quickly as Ness takes a 2-1 lead here with the classic Druid combo.
This is pretty impressive how Ness is keeping his calm and, you know, like just watching his facial expressions. It seems like he's relieved right now that he won this game, but definitely he is playing his A game at the moment. At least with the Druid versus Druid mirror.
Well, yeah, Emperor, innovate.
Yeah, I mean, sign of a good player. He's really good at innovating Emperor Thorasan. You cannot argue with that. So as far as things are going in this series, he's performing well with Druid, but you know, not to sell him short, there was a couple of actually really important decisions on a couple of turns that matchup. We maybe had an issue with one or two, but also one or two was really highly recognizing the situation and adjusting to things really well. So you know, it's not like the deck is autopiloting. He's getting very, very generous openings and being in a good position, but he's still having to secure the win on those spots.
The biggest decision I think he made was to not play the Dr. Boom, or could have played
yes.
it, and instead went for the Wrath and the Druid of the Claw, and
yep.
that was the biggest impactful decision, I think, in the game, apart of course from the Taurus and Innovate.
Yep.
But securing the bot position that wasn't weak to any kind of response from Life Coach was basically winning him the game.
Definitely. Right. And now we're going to see this Druid versus Demon Handlock, which is a bad matchup for Demon Handlock, but what Life Coach has to do to win? What are the best cards he can get in the first 5 turns?
Basically, you need your first threat as Handlock to go unanswered. So you need to get a Twilight Drake or a Big Giant on the board that doesn't get answered with Big Game Hunter or Keeper of the Grove from your opponent. If you get that platform down, then you can actually start playing the aggressor as the Handlock and take the initiative with big minions in play. If you just wait and wait and wait for the inevitable outcome of, you know, eventually Druid's going to get a board that you can't deal with, and then combo's going to do way too much damage. You know, you can't just go on forever in this matchup. So this is a pretty good-looking hand overall for Life Coach right now.
For Ness as well, he's only lacking the Wild Growth, but he again has Emperor, Innovate into Emperor.
On turn 4 again, look at that.
You think for Life Coach this is the time when you drop the Void Caller?
That is every threat in his deck. Double Giant, Double Drake, and the Void Caller with Mal'Ganis inside it as well. That is the beefiest handlock hand I've ever seen in my life.
It is, but on turn three, what do you do? Like, as Lothar suggested, do you Void Caller or just pass and turn?
I mean, with all these four drops in hand, I think you can ration out the Giants for later. So you can afford to coin a four drop here, follow it up with another four. So coin Void Caller into Twilight Drake, coin Twilight Drake into Void Caller. You can do that either way around. If Life Coach doesn't do that, he's going to be in a very difficult position because Emperor will come down on an empty board on the next turn.
How greedy is Life Coach so far?
He's pretty greedy, but I would say with current curve in his hand, he will coin out something because it, basically by not coining a minion this turn, he gives away the coin for free because he doesn't have a two drop in his hand, so he can't tap. So he basically skips a turn. You're not allowed to do that against a druid. If druid gets his steam rolling, right, just damages your opponent, it's pretty, pretty tough to come back.
Now, I have no issue with this play whatsoever. I'm just kind of sharp intake of breath because based on his hand right now, Innovate Emperor is going to happen and there is no way of dealing with it if, unless he wants to trade into it and take the risk of getting the Doomguard from hand and not the Mal'Ganis.
Yeah, so it is possible that if Life Coach doesn't draw anything specific, it's possible the Emperor will actually take twice.
Yeah, exactly. Going the other way and coining out the Twilight Drake would have allowed him to Defender of Argus on the following turn and trade up into the Emperor Thorasan. This is not a criticism in any way of Life Coach's play. This is just an explanation of what's going to happen. With Mal'Ganis and Doomguard in hand, I think you'd be insane not to play the Void Caller on
that. Yeah, how can you predict? Third time in a row.
Three Innovate Emperors in three games. Yeah.
You can't predict that. Especially the first two were played on turn three instead of turn four.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, well, that's, I would say, you just ignore the Emperor in this situation and just play Twilight Drake.
Sure.
You can't really do anything else, in my opinion.
Well, Life Coach's hand is good enough, possibly, to be able to survive double turn Emperor, right? Like, Druid will have a lot of access to different cards, but Life Coach should be able to still fight back with all those great cards.
He is thinking about trading, though. If you get the Mal'Ganis out, he dies to basically everything. Because there's the Living Woods, there might be a Wrath, there might be a Swipe, there might be a Keeper. Everything dies. He dies to everything that will be played from Druid, so I'm not blaming him for just not trading here at all.
And how, honestly, how good is the situation even when you do win the roll and you get a Doomguard? Because you trade in a 3-4, then you trade 5 health of a 5-7 into it as well. Like, it's not even that good, right?
Yep.
Yeah, but let's talk about Ness's turn, because he is facing this 3-4 Void Caller. There can be a big demon. There can be a Doomguard.
There might be nothing also, but with the coin out on the Void Caller with the Twilight already in the hand that says to you, it sends a message, there's a huge demon in my hand, but you don't know which one.
Right, I like this line. Azir Drake, great pickup, boosting the value of this Living Roots, allowing the nice trade on board. You'll be shutting your eyes here as Ness and hoping for no Mortal Coil, which is a card we don't see yet. And now the third powerhouse demon comes into play.
That's actually not that important for Life Coach right now. He doesn't want the 315 on board unless he will taunt it up this turn.
Yeah, Defender of Argus. If he gets.
But do you want to taunt it up?
I probably need another threat just to fight back.
Yeah, Doomguard here, and he gets it. Turns green in his hand immediately, and now he has full board control again. Big Game Hunter is going to be needed, but some point here by Ness doesn't hit it.
All right.
The Dr. Boom for 5 mana.
Seems good.
Yeah, Dr. Boom is quite good here, and also he can just Wrath the Doomguard, 3 damage to it, so deal with the demon and have a really good threat. He also picks Savageur, which will be really important for the future turns.
This game is ridiculous when you think about it. There's like so much value for the mana invested from both sides. It's really crazy when you think about it. So
it's funny how Life Coach has no spells. He just
he's drawing every threat in his deck. Like,
every
it's insane.
Minion.
Double Mountain Giant, double Twilight Drake, Void Caller, Mal'Ganis, Molten Giant, Jiraxxus, Boom. Like, this is a deck that like you open up Hearthstone when you have a collection and just like, okay, I'm just gonna make like all of these dudes look awesome. Like, look at these massive dudes. I'm putting them in my deck. Like, there's just no utility in his hand right now. He's just gonna keep shutting his eyes and playing threats and hoping it's good enough to dominate the board right now.
Look at Lothep, it's just a vanilla 5/5, it does nothing.
But Ness is not aware of that, and I wouldn't blame him for playing Lothep right now. So if he plays the low tip, he plays around Shadow Flames. Actually, Shadow Flame doesn't do anything here.
Yeah.
Never mind.
Shadow Flame isn't even a big deal. I think Ancient of Lore just to cycle through your hand.
And Shredder for two mana.
Is a much better idea, especially since you can load up the Shredder alongside it exactly, Lothar.
But then Shadow Flame makes some sense.
Yep. Yeah, it sure does. But still, Ancient of Lore coming out here. Will be looking for that Force of Nature to match that Savage Roar. Doesn't get it. So Shredder is going to come down in the middle of the board here, and he's threatening a ton of damage here with the Savage Roar. Big Game Hunter drawn, Dr. Boom gone, the only target, so that is a pretty useless minion right now.
Yeah, you can't even play it at the moment because there's an 8-8 giant on board. So, Dr. Boom, I guess? Is there anything else? For the next turn, you can probably just Twilight and Defender of Argus.
Dr. Boom...
Yeah, I mean... Boom into Twilight Drake, Defender of Argus, into Mal'Ganis. Seems like the line here, potentially.
When it, the autoplay is on the Defender of Argus, and that's basically it, so there's no autoplay. Dr. Boom is the only way to fill out the mana curve and hope your opponent doesn't have double Savage Roar, as an example. Because
right.
That's 12, 16, 17 damage. Will be quite huge when you have already a swipe in hand.
Yeah.
And a Living Roots.
I think the important thing there as well from Life Coach is looking back at your opponent's hand, you know the Emperor went off for a couple of turns, so cards have been discounted, but if he's paying attention, he's seen all those cards get used apart from one.
Yes.
So the chance of him having a discounted combo in his hand is actually incredibly low, so he didn't really feel the need to fully play around combo on that turn by making a really passive Defender of Argus.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
Good decision here to attack first with Ness. He's probably going to try to clear with Swipe. Attacking first, not have an option.
Ooh.
A 4-5, interesting. If he gets Keeper of the Grove later in the game, he might actually attack with it. And it might soak some bomb damage. So we are going to see that swipe from him.
True damage to the face.
Yeah, so Swipe and Wrath is going to get used here. Enough mana left over for that Shade of Naxxramas, so going to still be generating a board here. And Ancient Watcher does the best job an Ancient Watcher has ever done, which is tanking two Boombots, protecting the face damage. Again, it could have been useful with a Ancient Watcher later on, but generally a pretty useless minion.
That was so brave.
Oh, he didn't play the Living Roots.
He didn't play the Living Roots. He feels like Living Roots might be concealed damage. It would work here, we know, because there is no...
I would say when you have a Savage Roar in hand, you kind of expose yourself to Hellfire, but...
I think also he has Lotheb in hand, so he can make a play where he generates Roots and Lotheb at the same time and sets up a bigger Savage Roar.
Yeah, that makes more sense.
So that's definitely something you can consider. And also, as Nimsh says, it's if finally like the last gasp taunt comes down with no healing, he can just fire the Living Roots face for the last pieces of damage he needs.
And now back to Life Coach. Voidcaller seems quite alright, but is this the moment where you just go Twilight Drake and Voidcaller, or are you afraid of the combo? Like, next turn is turn 9.
I think even though you are aware that your opponent was on top decking, so he would have to get the combo pieces in those 5 cards right now, because every single other card that he had in the initial hands and the initial draws were used is quite low. So going for that insane good taunts next turn is very appealing, and that's the last gasp of free air for him.
Absolutely. There's so much pressure in this game. Like, just looking at the Life Coach, he has trouble breathing even, because it's just sitting on the edge. It's like, do you have combo? If you do, I'm just dead. I just lost, eliminated from the tournament. This is the last deck for Life Coach. If he loses here, he's out.
This could be the ultimate swing turn for Life Coach right now, though.
Yep.
If he trades this Voidcaller and Lord Jaraxxus comes out and he's able to play Defender of Argus on a 3/15 and a 4/7, then this game could just end on the spot unless we see
Keeper of the Grove.
Not one, but two Keeper of the Groves come out of the deck.
Mal'Ganis is not even... I mean, both cards are good. I was thinking just about slamming first the Voidcaller into the Piled Shredder, so that's interesting, actually. Because you're exposed to the combo this way. You know there was no combo last turn, right? Because then you can trade your face and one minion, and then you kill your opponent with the combo. That's it. That'll be end of the game. So Life Coach banks on not having, of Ness not having the combo from the top of the deck right now. Very interesting choice.
Yeah, there is no combo, so a good call there. Greedy but successful. In a way. So for Ness, what do you do? Azure Drake can draw him a card and empower Living Roots to deal 3 damage. But Mal'Ganis is pretty annoying. I guess Big Game Hunter, though.
Yeah, Big Game Hunter would be such a huge deal right now.
Swipe is
a pretty big deal itself.
Yeah, swipe is quite good, but what do you swipe in what order?
I think you need to first kill the Mul'Ganis before you kill the Voidcaller. So I would sacrifice the Tutu first to not buff the minion from the Voidcaller. Because it gets buffed right now.
Why does it matter if it gets buffed?
If there will be another AoE, an example, right?
Sure, okay. Makes sense. But yeah, just trades off, gets control of the board. 315 in play. Now there is the potential for the Argus, but there's no good second target for the Argus now this turn. That's the concern I have with this line of play, where last turn just seems so spectacular with the Jiraxxus coming down, then you Argus up the 4-7, which can then trade into the Lotheb cleanly. Just looked like such a strong turn. So now there's just this situation where Defender of Argus doesn't quite get the job done because there's no big second target for
it. So interesting, because like you might think about tapping, which he did, but what else is there in the deck? Like we've seen the double Mountain Giant. Have we seen double Twilight Trip?
I think we've seen like every threat.
All the four drops, basically.
But the Sun Fury Protector that turn is a big draw, because now he can just use the Molten Giant and the Sun Fury Protector instead to still make the two big taunt.
I think it's a turn for the Big Game Hunter, because there are no more targets for it, right? And then you play the Defender of Argus and kill the Azure Drake. The Azure Drake with the... just kill one threat, right? So you make the Savage Roar less valuable for the next turn.
Sure. All right, yeah, I buy it.
Yeah.
And you still have a big minion, 5-3 minion, when you already saw two swipes being played. Sorry, one swipe, two Wraths, and one Living Druid being played.
It is two swipes. Two swipes have been used.
Two swipes?
Yeah,
okay,
yeah.
So almost every single removal from Druid was already used. So that 5-3 minion is basically trading with something, for sure.
A double Wrath was used as well, right?
Big Game Hunter, after both Mountain Giants and Dr. Boom has been used, it could still
and
come into play. And Mul'Ganis.
There's still a Molten Giant.
It could still come into play. This Molten Giant may end up taunted as well at some point in this game. So don't get me wrong, that Big Game Hunter is nice to have as Ness, but he will be looking at it right now saying, hey, bro, I thought you had my back.
But also shows the
where were you?
It also shows the genius of the play by Life Coach. As Lothar mentioned, not only it uses the Big Game Hunter when he had a chance, it also played around the Big Game Hunter from the opponent.
Sure. Yeah, absolutely. So Drew the Caller down in stats mode here. He knows that this game has got a little bit more on him. He knows it's got a little bit more on here, right? Like, he has to fight for the board a little bit again. He has to find a way through these walls in front of him. And Ancient Watcher comes out from the deck of the Handlock, a bit more effective as a card in this deck than the one we saw from the Shredder from the Druid side.
And Life Coach is back in the saddle. He survived turn 9, and now he is back with big taunts, and he still has a lot of taunt givers and a good situation overall.
What do you think about Ancient of War? Ancient Watcher. Never mind. Ancient Watcher into Defender of Argus into Dark Bomb, so you can trade with the Druid of the Claw, with the 2-3-4. Defender of Argus, or are we boosted?
Wait, so what are we Argusing? So Ancient Watcher in the middle, Argus on the two middle minions, trade.
Exactly.
Yeah, I like it. Seems like a solid play, but I also like just jamming Emperor Thorasan on this board.
So you trade with the Jiraxxus instead of the Dark Bomb, right? Instead,
yeah. You can trade with Jiraxxus and a 2-3 as well. I guess 2-3 that needed on board. Like, you go face with the face.
Yeah, that makes sense too.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, like,
so you play the Ancient Watcher this time as well.
Oh, a mind control tech was being shown.
Yeah, he's seen
mind control tech
from his opponent, so you absolutely don't play the Ancient Watcher. That's completely correct.
There's the combo.
So finally, after all those years,
that's almost lethal, because the one target has to be, like, basically the Shade of Necromancer kills the Jiraxxus, and then you have 4 damage. That is not enough to kill Life Coach, right?
No. Yeah, it's not enough, but he will be able to deal 10 damage to face. Put him on 4.
So if the... even then. I was going to say, if this one of the combo pieces got discounted, so he could hero power as well and get the 3 damage cleanly into the Big Game Hunter, that would have been better,
but still not enough
to push through, yeah. So he's just going to have to ration this out as a board clear play. He does have that Big Game Hunter in hand now, which gives him a lot more utility going forward. So looks like he's even going to sacrifice his Shade to pick up a full board clear here.
Oh, wow, he's trading.
Yep.
All right.
All right, he has both swipes being traded already.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Pushing
for damage.
The claw?
One Druid of the Claw at least. It might even be 2. But yeah, pushing for damage doesn't really make any sense here. He knows he has to kind of get himself back onto the board. The only real damage left in his deck is the second combo at this point, and Keepers of the Grove, which don't really do huge amounts of bursts.
And Lycos is like, comfortably tapping at 10 HP.
right? And here's the thing as well. I mean, clearing those last threats from Life Coach's deck actually makes a lot of sense because, again, let's go back through the list of everything we've seen. Double Mountain Giant, double Twilight Drake, Jiraxis, double Foycaller, Jiraxis, Mal'Ganis, and now a Molten. So how does Life Coach actually get back on this board now and build up a board presence that actually kills Ness from this position?
And Ness still has one more Ancient of Lore, I believe, in his deck.
Quite possibly.
Yeah, one Ancient of Lore and one Druid with the Claw, if I remember correctly.
One Aspirant.
One Aspirant and one Force of Nature, one Savage Roar.
Yeah, Force of Nature, Savage Roar, if there are no taunts, will put Ness in a great position.
Well, he needs to play some taunts.
9 cards left in Ness's deck, 10 left in Life Coaches. Honestly, like, the fatigue consideration isn't the most ridiculous thing in the world here because both players have used so many of their heavy hitters right now.
All right, this Molten Giant is going down. I want to see Life Coach's face. There is the first part
Savage
of the combo.
Roar.
If he gets Force Nature next turn, that would be really dangerous. Life Coach still has Ancient of Watcher.
Oh, that's a huge pickup.
Yeah, Healbot is great for Life Coach, definitely. He can get not only a Tone Wall and clear the 4-2, but also go up to 14.
I think you have to double coil that Big Game Hunter. With so few threats left in your deck, you need to respect what minions you have on board and make sure they stay there. So
you have to make sure that you don't die to double combo. I mean, to the second combo, right? So let's say you use 2 mana to kill off the Big Game Hunter. You have one taunter left on the board, which shows up 4 mana. So you still die to the remaining combo pieces. So you need to put 2.
Just play Healbot, right? Like,
Healbot, or you put 2 tones, and that's enough as well.
Yeah.
There are a lot of options.
Yeah, I think Life Coach is still in a good position.
Even a 3-2 minion right now is very valuable.
Yeah, exactly. And that's what I'm saying. You have to, with all your big threats gone, you have to kind of respect this this little board that you're building up of just small, annoying guys and try and carry this all the way to the bank. So I love using the double Mortal Coil there instead of the trading the 2-3. He knows he needs to keep initiative on the board as best he can right
now. The consecutive damage that will be just piling on every single turn will just finish off the game here.
Ancient of Lore will be a great pick by Ness. Interesting, there is this Mind Control deck, which Life Coach is actually playing around.
And pretty well. Second AC deck.
Oh, hello.
Yeah, there's that double ooze tech that freaked me out yesterday when I was talking about how rogues like to build up big daggers against Handlock because there generally isn't weapon destruction, and then Life Coach makes me look like a moron by playing double ooze in his deck. So,
But to be fair, most of the rogues are just spamming the weapon the same turn they're playing Blade Flurries,
right.
So those weapon destructions.
By the way, double ooze is not bad here. Even if you want to play around Mind Control tech, just spamming double ooze is fine.
Sure.
Double swipe is gone. Like, how is Druid going to react to this? You're not dead to combo because you have a taunt and you're at 14. You have a lot of minions, so if Mind Control tech comes and steals your best minion, being a taunt, you still have a taunt follow-up.
Okay, now you have to overextend with every single minion. If you play that Molten Giant and you stop playing around Mind Control tech, you need to spam other minions as well. And what is even more important, I don't think you even taunt up this turn.
You might
a combo doesn't kill you.
If you do, you don't taunt up the mountain.
Yeah, I was going to say, you can taunt some other irritating stuff just to get another 2-3 on the board. That's perfectly fine. It's just you need to make sure Mind Control tech doesn't take that 8-8. So this makes a ton of sense.
Wow, and this looks like the game for Life Coach, so he stays alive.
Oh, now the Innovate is not really a good card. So before we started discussing this matchup, we said that in general, Handlock is not favored against Druid.
Right.
And a particular scenario is needed for the Handlock to win this matchup. And we saw actually that.
Yep. It was big early threats with no answer. No Big Game Hunter, no silence. Whatever the answer is, it needs to be missing for the Druid. And that's exactly what happened.
So just Life Coach having the best possible hand in a way, and then Ness just missing the cards, even though he had Torison on turn 4.
Right, it's like when you're trying to pick out weaknesses of Druid, like what's the one big thing that comes up, right? Like they can't honestly deal with big minions on the board.
Yeah.
Like big stat minions, if they have to deal with them purely through damage, they can't really do it. So it was just 8 health guy, followed by 7 health guy, followed by 7 health guy, followed by 8 health guy, and just Druid just ran out of ways to keep control of the board eventually.
But I think we can't really simplify it that much because there was a lot of decision making from both players, and even like coming back to turn 3 where Life Coach had to make a decision which minion to play, if you even want to play a minion, how to deal with Torison.
Right.
He actually left Torison online for like 2 turns and reducing the card cost. So I think a lot of decision making from both Ness and Life Coach there. And now we're down to Warlock versus Warlock. And Ness is playing a weird list.
There's Zombie Chows.
Yeah, there's Zombie Chows and there's early Zoo cards, and then he curves into more mid-rangey stuff. There's a Sylvanas in there, there's a Hellfire and a Shadow Flame, there's Dart Bombs. It's not a Reno list, let's get that out of the way straight away. There are loads of duplicates, no Reno in the deck. It just literally is mid-range Warlock. It's just Warlock that tries to curve out, has late game threats as well.
What's fun is that Warlock is the only class that allows you to make different archetypes solely because you have the life tap effect.
Yeah, hero power. Right. He mulliganed away the Zombie Chow, kept Thorson.
I mean, interesting stuff. It's obviously a very flexible list. It has such a wide variety of cards in it that you can try and pull out the right half of your deck for the right situation. And obviously, the small Zombie Chow and Imp Gang boss isn't what he was looking for against the huge minions that come out early from Handlock. So he's obviously just looking for the bigger, meatier portion of his deck right now. And Emperor, Sylvanas, Owl, these are some pretty solid cards to have overall.
Absolutely. Big Game Hunter and Owl and Mortal Coil for the possible threats. Looks pretty good. He is missing a demon now.
So is it... That's my another question. Is Life Coach even playing Shadow Flame?
We haven't seen any.
Yeah, we've seen like zero spells. We saw a couple of Mortal Coils towards the end.
No Hellfires.
Yeah, we didn't see Hellfire. We just saw like massive dude after massive dude come out of his deck.
To be honest, he had to cut something for the oozes.
Right. I mean, that's very true. It's obviously a really greedy list. Like, most of these are Demon Handlock variations that play the Void Caller Mal'Ganis package are cutting Mountain Giants to make room for that, just to kind of make the deck a little bit less clunky. He's playing all the threats, plus Acidic Ooze, plus the three Taunt Givers at least that we saw, plus like everything. It's insane how he's packed everything into this.
How do I hold all those threats?
Yeah, exactly. It's crazy.
But it's not looking good for Life Coach. There's no good play. Like, every single play might be punished from your opponent, so now we just have to take the risk, calculate which are the best odds, what are the best odds for which card. So in Mountain Giant, it seems like the best choice because there's only Big Game Hunter that punishes you.
Yeah.
Void Caller is being punished by a silence. Twilight Drake being punished by silence and a Mortal Coil. So not an easy decision to make for Life Coach. And there's the Big Game Hunter.
Yeah, it's the first one at least. We don't know how many Big Game Hunters Ness is playing. But overall, if you look at Life Coach's hand, it's quite good. Like, he got the threats he wanted in the very beginning. He will be able to follow up with Mountain Giant again if he chooses to. He has Thorison for turn six.
Yeah, I think Life Coach, as the established Handlock player as he is, will recognize that the play here is tap Mountain Giant. He understands the greed of needing to tap there, discounts the Mountain Giant to three mana, plays it out. But Lotheb is a pretty nice card here just to curve out, and Ness can continue to be aggressive here if he would like to.
I think it's the correct way to play this matchup, just being overly aggressive. Mm-hmm. The thing is, if I understand correctly how Ness built this deck, is that you want to win with a bulky minion that goes to the face, right?
Right.
And the only way you can win against a Handlock is to actually first deal the damage with the minions to finish off with some burst damage from your hand.
Yeah, absolutely.
And the burst damage might be just Hellfires and Dark Bombs. So you need to be overly aggressive and just ignore the threat of Molten Giants.
Mm. I mean, honestly, this deck can play very similarly to Handlock in a lot of matchups. It plays a lot of similar cards. It just has kind of an extra kind of lower curve threat that can help it fight more evenly on the board against more aggressive decks. So we saw with his Mulligan decision that he committed to kind of playing this matchup Handlock to Handlock, but he's established such an advantage with that swingy Big Game Hunter that he's able to be the aggressor in this situation.
This turn is really tricky, by the way. He can go for Lotheb and go face, probably, with the minions and be really aggressive because he has Hellfire in the hand. There was a really weird play where you attack with the Big Game Hunter into the giant, you Hellfire, and then you Coil, and you leave your Voidwalker on one health and be like, hey, like, just kill it. Try my demons in my hand. But I think this is a bit better, even though Lotheb is great in the matchup overall to block the Shadow Flame later in the game.
What do you do? Emperor? Very risky, you're very low. 14 HP, your opponent has 7 attack if you trade with the Lotheb. So there's a lot of options you will actually die next turn. Because, well, no, not maybe die, because it's 6 damage with the Hellfire Dark Bomb, so it's 10, 13, 1 off. But when you're 1 off against a Handlock,
it's tough. What about Twilight Sun Fury Kilothub? It's you kill the biggest threat on board, you have two taunts set up.
Yeah, Twilight Sun Fury is definitely a solid option here. It's just, I think one of the things that you establish as you go on more and more playing Handlock is that you get greedier and greedier, because Handlock is one of the decks that you do get very, very greedy with, and it's correct to do so. You kind of get better at the deck by being greedier, by waiting longer to taunt, by waiting longer to heal. So I think Life Coach will make some sort of defensive play here, but honestly, slamming Emperor wouldn't have been the worst thing in the world. Lothar broke down exactly, like, this is the maximum damage I can expect my opponent to do with six mana, so wouldn't have been the most ridiculous thing in the world to see that come out. But with the Voidcaller on the board, the Doomguard is able to come out here if it's busted through, and using the taunt to maximize the chances of that happening.
Yeah, and Ness picks up a demon, which is really important for him at this very moment. How much damage does he have?
We can only push the 7 to face this turn with the 4 from the Big Game Hunter and the Hellfire, but
Defender of Argus looks juicy, though.
Yeah, Defender of Argus is looking pretty promising right now to set this up.
5 damage to the face, so your opponent is a 9. Still doesn't set up any kind of lethal next turn if your opponent will be able to clear. I mean, Lapka doesn't know there's no demon in his opponent's hand, right? And that might actually signal him that. Because if the Voidcaller is not being taunted up, there might be no demon in your opponent's hand.
Yeah.
Right?
And then Ness is obviously playing around Molten Giants as well. Just if you go for face, the 9 health, Molten Giant, Shadow Flames, possibly double Molten Giants, Defender of Argus.
Yep. Lots of terrible things can happen when you lower hand locks down below 10. It just creates such insane tempo play possibilities for them. But again, the mulligan decision from Ness has really set this out, because he did send away those kind of small irritating early game minions that he didn't want, set himself out to play like a more mid game style, but then just by extension of his deck just being that little bit faster than Life Coaches, he's been able to establish himself as the aggressor throughout the matchup.
Yeah, I think like throwing away Zombie Chow was in a way correct, because Big Game Hunter, Iron Beguile, those cards are more key than just starting to deal damage and maybe just even get Dark Bomb.
Emperor's thing. Okay, so that's 5 damage and your opponent can still deal only 7. So that's 12. 2 of lethal, basically. Unless there will be a PO.
And hey, that is not a PO, but it's the closest card in Hearthstone to a PO. Dark Peddler, the Power Overwhelming Generator, is a pretty good shout right now.
Can also be our Soulfire.
Also be Soulfire, yeah.
Interesting.
Let's see. So if you go for the Dark Peddler, you get self. Let's say you get the PO or the Soulfire. That's 4 damage, and you have 3 damage already in the hand, so that's 12 still.
Just
Emperor's. I was thinking about Sylvanas instead, to be honest. Sylvanas in this position would be almost an immovable object.
It's possible that there is Siphon Soul, I guess. Siphon's a possibility at all, like in a demon.
I think if you've seen the amount of threats that came out from Life Coach, you can make the decision that there is no Siphon Soul in this deck. It's a very fringe card in Handlock these days anyway. And I think when you're trying to make this much room for that many threats and acidic swamp oozes and everything else that you've seen, I think Siphon Soul is one of the cards that almost certainly disappears.
Yeah, but it's a very good reasoning, but how much of the reasoning Ness can apply?
Yeah,
being
absolutely
at the stage stressed and probably not seeing this deck for some time.
Oh, the healbot was being burned. Is that important?
He does have a couple of taunt minions in hand, so he might be able to defend his life total on the board as opposed to just straight up healing with the antique healbot. So might end up not being that important. I think it's a price Life Coach would be willing to pay for that Doomguard killing the Emperor Thoris armor.
Probably
put it that way. Yeah.
And now Ness can easily deal with the 5/2. He also picks the Belcher. But this Sylvanas right now is also quite nice.
Is it? Let's see. If you play Sylvanas, your opponent...
You have Fire Sylvanas, I think.
There's that Zombie Chow finally back into the hand. Not what Ness is looking for right now. There is the Soulfire. Picks it immediately, jams the Sylvanas onto the board, and now he's kind of got this awkward situation where Sylvanas needs to be dealt with, because if Life Coach doesn't deal with it, he's kind of threatening lethal with this massive damage that he has in hand, just with that 5/5 on board.
Yeah, how do you deal with Sylvanas without actually losing a minion, giving a minion away?
Too bad you don't give away a minion that has 7 attack. Because then you could have just destroyed with the big one.
So you just play your Dr. Boom, trade the Doomguard, get the 7 stolen, and then BGH it. Best play EU.
Actually, there might be the case that you need to play the Dr. Boom. Because you kill the Sylvanas. You kill the first the 2-2 with the Twilight Drake. You play Dr. Boom. You sacrifice the Doomguard into Sylvanas. Hope that your opponent either gets the 7-7 or the bomb. And that's about it.
Yeah, I guess she's going for it.
I really wanted to steal the 7-7 now, just for pure comedy value. This will be so sick. Come on, steal the 7-7. Come on, be a bro.
So the best outcome for Ness is if it steals the Drake.
And a bomb is being taken. So now I would say you have to taunt up.
Yep, I think the taunt will most certainly come down here. It's one of the annoying factors of Dr. Boom that it interrupts the Sun Fury protector positioning, so he can't taunt up large minions here. Those Boombots always come out and annoy, and Sylvanas could have stolen the Boombot that was in the way, so he could have made up the taunt. So stealing the left-hand minion is actually very relevant there.
Good Sylvanas.
Second Peddler. And you mentioned that Ness is playing Azure Drake, right?
Kamlan is playing.
Kamlan is playing.
That would be actually a huge deal, just to spell power those spells like Hellfire and Soulfire.
Yeah.
Well, he can still get a second Soulfire and then maybe not discard the first one, but drawing a card first makes sense.
Yeah, gonna Mortal Coil to dig here. It's up a second Zombie Chow again, not the cards he's looking for. Gets 4 to face, though, that's huge!
Is he getting a
Soulfire number 2 from Peddler.
Is there anything else?
That is ridiculous.
If he gets a Soulfire now, and if Life Coach gets eliminated because of that Soulfire,
The wince on Ness told you everything you needed to know before we even saw the cards. You saw from the facial expression that there was no Soulfire.
I just want to remind everyone that last tournament, Life Coach got eliminated because we've seen Dark Peddler, Dark Bomb!
Not enough mana. One of mana. He has it next turn, and now, Lothar, you asked the question, how important is that Healbot getting discarded?
The answer to that question
is extremely important.
Match-changing Healbot.
Yep.
But that Doomguard was important.
It was necessary. Yeah. It was necessary, but I did not think the Healbot was going to be that important with these taunts in hand protecting from board, but I didn't factor in the amount of extra burn this deck plays.
Guys, look at Ness. Ness is like, please. Please do not play heal. Do not play Lothar.
Mal'Ganis drawn doesn't help at all here because you can't sacrifice your own Void Caller even if you play it like this turn.
It's so easy to get excited from our position here because we can see the match situation, but does Life Coach recognize that he has to tap? The answer is yes, he does. Goes ahead and taps down, needed to hit Lothar or Antique Healbot to get himself out of this. Doesn't get either of them. So Ness is going to continue to hold his breath for a few more seconds here.
Oh my
He's
god.
He's going to get the news very soon that we are going to have a UK representative in the top four.
And Life Coach again eliminated in the top 8 by the Soulfire from Dark Peddler. It happened in December.
It's not even about the health, the Soulfire, it's about the bomb. The Dark Bomb, the Boombot just dealt 4 damage to his face. What it could have hit 3 other minions and deal between 1 to 4 damage instead.
And Life Coach knows, he's like, no, please. Dargon to face, he's already taking the headset out. Hellfire into Soulfire, well played by Life Coach, and Ness is going to the top 4.
Congrats to Ness. Quite a fest of some RNG cards here. In the whole match, in every single game, there was those discards from Doomguards, Innovates, the what else was there? Like the Boombots, of course, the Mind Control Tech.
Yeah, Mind Control Tech, just the three really insane draws with Druid getting down the Emperors really quickly as well. So, yeah, lots of swingy games in general there, but overall well navigated by Ness. Life Coach didn't do too much wrong himself. He fought against some tough matchups overall with aplomb and only was narrowly edged out by Ness's slightly quicker mid-rangey Warlock deck. So I'm personally over the moon to have a UK representative in the top 4. I think overall, Ness has had one series on stream where he played fairly poorly, one series on stream where he played excellently, and then I think that series was, he played okay.
Yeah,
he played okay. So, on average, he's not doing too bad, but I think he is still going to have to raise his game a level if he wants to keep going all the way through to the
I have to say that Ness played definitely okay, but the lineup that he brought was super interesting to watch because the Priest, this kind of Warlock. Druid maybe was a bit more standard, but Mind Control tech is an interesting tech choice in the deck. But overall, this match, like, you know, metagame, when you think about the metagame at the very moment, you think Zoo, Patron, Druid, Secret Paladin. But we've seen Demon Handlock versus Druid. We've seen a no win condition Rogue versus Priest. Those are not the games you watch every day.
Right, and just speaking about the lineups, you know, that series could have easily lined up very differently. Say if the Handlock came up against the Priest, for example, that is just a disgusting matchup for the Priest. It's ones that priests queue into on ladder and back in the day, and would just, do I just concede on turn one and save myself
well,
the time? Because
it changed with the introduction of Flash Heals.
It did, yeah, but yeah, back in the day, you'd always get to that point where, you know, you always felt like 15 turns in, okay, I've got a chance, and then finally something would come down and just crush you out if there was no Jiraxxus.
So, that's true.
I mean, the lineups could have come out in a different way if the pick order was different, but overall, both players played well. Nestus had that slight edge with the critical mass of burn damage in the Warlock Mirror at the end.
Absolutely. So now Nestus joining Powder and Dog in the top four, and we have one more match for you guys. The fourth quarterfinal is Pokrovac versus Kamlan. Give us some time, though. We need to prepare the players, and we'll be back after a couple of minutes after break.